I hope you enjoyed your quick break. My name is Xiaoyu Weng. I'm an associate curator here at the Guggenheim Museum. Thank you, Leeza. Thank you, Christina, for introducing the program. And also, it was a fantastic first session of today's film meeting. I'm one of the co-curators of the exhibition Tales of Our Time, currently on view in the Tower 4 and 5 gallery at the museum. So when you have a chance, please go to see the exhibition. I want to make a little bit announcement here because one of the pieces in the exhibition will be actually shutting down with the closing of the museum today around 6 o'clock because it's a very complex mechanical piece. So if you would love to get a sneak peek of how that work actually displayed in operation, please run to Tower 5 when you have a chance before 6 o'clock today. Today we have on the stage with me two artists, Xyza Cruz Bacani and Chia-En Jao. I'm going to introduce the artist, and this special 45-minute program is sort of a little panel, mini panel that we inserted into today's film meeting. And thank you, Leeza, for letting us do this very much. Originally from the Philippines, Xyza Cruz Bacani is a photographer. She's known for her black and white photographs of Hong Kong street life. At the age of 18, she joined her mother in Hong Kong, working as a nanny for an affluent family in mid-levels. Bacani started taking casual photographs after purchasing her first digital single-lens reflex camera, a Nikon D90, with a loan from her employer. She's one of the Magnus Foundation's Human Rights Fellows and is the recipient of a resolution passed by the Philippines House of Representatives in her honor, HR number 1969. Xyza is one of the BBC's 100 Women of the World 2015, 30 Under 30 Women Photographers in 2016, Forbes 30 Under 30 Asia 2016, and a Fujifilm ambassador. Among her various street photography images of Hong Kong society, she has covered 2014 Hong Kong protests in Central and documented the lives of other domestic helpers in various places, such as Hong Kong and Singapore. In a little bit, Bacani is going to play some of the photographs that he shot over the years, and she will give an introduction of her practice and her very intimate relationships with the subjects that she worked with. Our second speaker, Chia-En Jao, whose work is currently on view and featured in the exhibition Tales of Our Time. Chia-En is an artist based in Taipei. He graduated from the Taipei National University of the Arts in 2000. After that, Chia-En spent 7 years in Europe and finished his study in Paris and London. He returned to Taiwan in 2007 and started to work with the local communities in his art practice. Chia-En approaches contemporary art practice as a set of experiments that deal with ideas of identities, borders, shared experience, and the power relationship between different aesthetic and political regimes. He has had solo exhibition at the Cube in Taipei and participated numerous international biennials. And in the exhibition Tales of Our Time, you will see this time Chia-En actually worked with local taxi drivers and engaged them with a very personal and intimate narration of history that versus the narrative of the more mainstream and grandiose history of Taiwan. And in today's conversation, Chia-En will actually talk about an older work that he worked with the migrant domestic workers from the Southeast Asia, but currently based in Taiwan. I think when we think about practice as today's theme of the field meeting, both of these two artists One is from a more of a journalist photographer background. The other is more from a so-called contemporary art field. For them, the idea of practice is also to engage with the community and engage with people that are not necessarily from an art background. And this made me think a lot about how we as practitioners to translate our language and to leave behind the jargons that we often use in contemporary art world, and how can these practice really become effective among the communities of different people in the society. Also, at the same time, after the two artists give their presentation, we will have a little conversation, and I will pose questions to each of them, and then we will open it up to the audience for questions. So I will hand the microphone to Bacani and let her start.
Hi. First of all, I would like to thank Xiaoyu for bringing me over here, and of course, the amazing Leeza. Before I come here at the stage, I have this struggle a while ago on how to present my work. Should I present this as a photojournalist, or should I present this as a visual artist or an activist? And then I realized that my struggles of labels will actually make me more nervous. So. I'm just lucky to be here right now and to present you these stories of these people who are often invisible and often ignored around us. So this is about a little bit of context. It's about human labor trafficking that is very rampant around the world, but it's not really often talked about. When people think about trafficking, they associate it with sex trafficking. But actually, it's labor trafficking that happens a lot of time. Human labor trafficking doesn't have a face, because we can never identify a person if she's a victim or not, because most of the time, there's no physical proof that a person is a victim. I could have chosen to present the work or photograph the process of trafficking to get more compelling, gory images. But then I realized that by doing that, I'm actually re-victimizing them. I chose to present their aftermaths or their survival because I think it's more inspiring for me as an artist or as a photographer to show that they chose to be humans or remain as humans no matter what they've gone through. So this is human labor trafficking taken from 5 different countries, which I'm lucky to be able to do, and it's still ongoing. Yes, please. So this project actually started here in New York when I came, for the first time I came here in New York last 2015 for the Magnum Human Rights Fellowship. And I was doing, of course, I'm a migrant worker myself, that's my background, so I decided to do a story about undocumented migrant workers here in New York. But while I was doing that, I stumbled upon the cases of human labor trafficking. One of my practices as a photographer is going to places that are often these people go. So while I was at the park, I asked people and they told me about human trafficking, and I was really shocked about it because this is a first world country. It's New York, and I never realized that it was happening. So I've met this lady who was trafficked and was not able to see her children for 7 years. This is in Upper East Side, and it's beautiful that she allowed me to photograph her on her work. This photo is taken in Hong Kong, where my roots as an artist or as a photographer started. This is part of my project about abused domestic workers in Hong Kong. This is in New Jersey, where they're doing barbecue. This is in Singapore, where child labor is very rampant. I just finished a project for the Pulitzer last October, and I'm planning to get it out by this December about Singapore. They might ban me, but it's worth it. So this is also in New York, where this is a Muslim lady who was trafficked. She was a teacher in the Philippines. The thing, we discussed this last time on a lunch or over lunch about migrant workers losing their identity once they come over to work as domestic workers. It's a practice for me to explain to people that these migrant workers, before they leave their home, they were someone else. They were teachers, they were managers, they were nurses, they were doctors. But then because of these unfortunate circumstances, they lost all their identities. And people, often the society, see them as only migrants. This is Daisy having a Skype conversation with her kids. This photo resonates to me a lot because I'm a child of a migrant worker myself. I haven't seen my mom since I was seven, and I was only able to know her when I was 19 when we started working together. This is a photo of someone who was burned. It's by a pot of boiling hot soup. This really makes me angry because it's 2015, or I took this 2014, and this kind of abuses still happens behind closed doors. This is them in Hong Kong every Sunday. This is also in Singapore. And also in Singapore. When people ask me why do I do this project, because honestly, in documentary photography, there's no money on it. I do it because I care about it. And before I start a project, which I always ask myself, why do I care and how can I make other people care? I want these people to be more relatable and not being seen as just victims. I want people to see them as human beings just like us. When I published this story in New York Times last year, some of the people commented, why is she using a MacBook if she's a victim? That really pissed me off. That's annoying. Like, why can't she afford a MacBook? She's working. So that question actually made me realize that I should keep on doing this project, showing the reality of life of these migrant workers, to try to tell to people that they're not just victims, but human beings just like us. It's more on like humanizing factor. So with the world upside down right now, I mean, with what is happening, I think I've never felt more compelled to continue giving, or if I say giving voices, it's very arrogant of me. But I've never been more compelled to give these people a platform to magnify their voices. Because sometimes we forget as practicing artists or photographers that our subjects have their own voices. The problem is we can't hear them. So as a photographer, as an artist, I'm very privileged that they allow me to give them a microphone and shout or tell their stories. And thank you very much for allowing me right now to tell their stories. That's my presentation. Thank you.
Should we go back? Just play the advertisement first. Then we go to the video at the end.
Yeah.
Okay. So I will now give the microphone to Chia-En, and he actually has some clips of videos to show you first.
So maybe I can give you a very brief timeline. About what I'm doing, because every work happened to me is a specific time I made it. So in 2010 I went back to Taiwan, and there's a lot. I noticed lots of social change in terms of population composition. So I traced back the economic policy. Trace back to my experience, my memory, because in Taiwan we have the longest martial law from 49 to 87. So 87 they ended the martial law. Then we need a new economic model. So they invented this kind of go south policy, go South Asia, go there to invest, to bring the laborers to Taiwan, to lower the cost, to compete with China, actually. So when I was away from 2000 and to 2010, when I went back home, there are lots of immigrant workers around me, around us. But normally, the Taiwanese people didn't really treat them very well. And I feel very sorry about that. And we saw them in the elevator everywhere, but we don't talk. So because I was foreigner in the past 10 years, so I try to, then I think I can try to learn their language to communicate with them. So I tried to find their language school. So I start to learn Thai language and the Vietnamese language. The initiated idea is do some graffiti on the wall, saying like, sorry, my neighbors shouting at you last night in their language. And then that was my research about who is going to learn their language, who is want to know their culture, because in 90s, there is a Japanese soap opera, so everyone learned Japanese. And in 2000, the Korean opera, everyone in Taiwan, you can find easily a Korean language class. But if you want to learn Indonesian or Thai language, it's really hard. In the end, after that experience, I organized one kind of events within our world, try to teach the our foreign language from Southeast Asia. And after that, it comes out another piece called I Am Sleep. It's, I think I should talk that now is because of time. So there's a rapid eye movement sleep, the title. It's a scientific term about the stage we have a dream image production in our mind. So because in appearance we are different, our skin, our height, everything, we have a lot of symbol outside. But I'm curious what kind of image will be produced during their working period when they are working in Taiwan. So the project comes out, I try to negotiate with their boss, try to get into their sleeping place, private place, to interview them. And because I don't speak their language, so that makes the project actually going quite well, because I have only A4 paper with me. It's just a shooting process. It's close your eye to count until 60 seconds, and then open your eyes, introduce yourself, your name, where you're from, what kind of job you're doing here, and how many hours you sleep. After that, you talk most vivid dream when you are working in Taiwan. After that, close your eye until I say cut. During the shooting, I don't know exactly the content because the language barrier. And after the translation, it's kind of shocking for me because in the beginning, I think there will be two screen video projection. One is good dreams, one is nightmare. In the end, 99% dream was nightmare. And they are from Indonesia, from Philippines, from Vietnam, different country, different cultural background. But their dream is kind of a unified in some way. The content is really similar. So that was another shock for me. So in the end, I kind of edited that in a three-channel video projection, a different screen size. So I think I will just play the video first. You think I should play that? Okay. So before that, I should show you the commercial. Which one is the green one? Because when I... That is actually an actor, very famous right now. This commercial is in late 80s. It's talk about energetic dream for local laborers. But at that time, the laborers are all Taiwanese, so they sing in Taiwanese. And later, this actor became very famous and playing a Crouching Tiger and a Hidden Dragon, right? So then you can see the image production, the process going from local to global. It's the same in our real world, from local laborers to international laborers. That is the system we have. So that's the thing is why I did that piece, because at that moment in 2010, it's kind of going to a very, kind of a phenomenon happening in Taiwan. So let's go back to the video. So drinking energetic work. So this is, I think, the video installation photos. So there are they all play in the same time, and two is slowing down, so you can see the body gesture when they're moving their finger. One screen is talking about their dreams, most vivid dreams. And let's go back. And actually, during that time, I organized this event to teach our people about their language, Thai language, and the map.
It should be this one. Here.
Yeah. So.
Nama saya Puja Astuti. Saya di Taiwan biasa dipanggil dengan Atu. Saya di Taiwan sudah 2 tahun setengah. Dalam sehari saya tidur antara 7 sampai 8 jam. Akhir-akhir ini saya sering mimpi buruk. Mimpi tiba-tiba saya berada di Indonesia, sedangkan dalam mimpi saya sadar bahwa saya belum selesai kontrak selama 3 tahun. Di sana saya di Indonesia, di rumah saya sangat bingung. Bingung kenapa saya berada di sini, kenapa tiba-tiba saya berada di rumah, berada di Indonesia. Sedangkan semua orang tidak tahu mengapa saya tiba-tiba berada di Indonesia. Saya sangat bingung bagaimana dengan nenek saya, siapa yang menjaga nenek saya, bagaimana dengan proses pekerjaan saya. Kemudian saya berlari ke PT bertanya, mengapa saya berada di sini sedangkan saya merasa tidak menandatangani finish kontrak. Mengapa saya tiba-tiba berada di Indonesia, sedangkan PT saya tidak mengetahui apapun. Lalu saya menelpon majikan saya. Majikan saya berkata bahwa tiba-tiba saya pulang dan majikan saya tidak tahu. Kemudian majikan saya sudah mengambil pembantu baru. Saya sangat sedih sekali. Karena majikan saya sangat baik. Kemudian saya ingin segera kembali ke Taiwan, tapi segala kendala terus saja terjadi. Seperti tiket pesawat tidak ada dan lain-lain. Kemudian mimpi-mimpi itu sering begitu datang, sering sekali datang. Tetapi setelah saya bilang kepada majikan kalau saya ingin kembali lagi bekerja di sini, mimpi-mimpi itu tidak lagi datang.
Nama saya Ani. Saya dari Indonesia. Saya datang ke Taiwan sudah 4 tahun. Pertama datang saya umur 23 tahun dan sekarang saya umur 27 tahun. Saya di Taiwan jaga ama. Sehari saya tidur 8 jam. Suatu malam saya pernah mimpi dikejar-kejar ama hingga akhirnya saya kelelahan duduk di sofa dan nenek pun duduk di sofa. Saya bergeser, nenek ikut bergeser, hingga akhirnya nenek gigit leher saya. Saya berteriak kesakitan. Nenek tetap gigit leher saya hingga berdarah. Saya bertirak kencang hingga saya terbangun dan melihat jam-jam 12 malam. 2 minggu setelah mimpi, amaku meninggal.
The video is over 50 minutes long, so we probably should stop here. And we still have 15 minutes, and I'm going to start with a couple of questions to both artists and apologize again for not being able to play Bacani's video. If you're interested, we can probably show you later. I would love to start with a question for Chia-En. As Bacani also earlier mentioned that she doesn't want to victimize her subject matter. I wanted to know what was your intention when you choose to work with these workers, although you already mentioned a little bit. Also, can you maybe share a little bit about the experience, how they react when you first ask about this possibility in collaborating with them?
Actually, I start to work actually with my wife to this project because she's female, I'm male, right? So it's a kind of important to do this project together. Otherwise, it's a kind of difficult to get trust by other people, by the female workers and the boss. So when I ask this project to do, the first question is who are you and why are you going to do this? And normally I just introduce myself as a documentary filmmaker or artist, and I try to investigate this kind of image production things. So I try to be as honest as possible to them because we need the trust in between us. So of course, in the beginning, the subject matter come to me because, like I say, I'm a foreigner before, and I say that is alienation between the societies quite things of quite bad experience for me. So in the beginning, that's the ideas starting point.
And Xyza, I wanted to ask you because your photographs are published on a much wider platform. Mm-hmm. Actually, much more people seen your photo probably than seen Chan's work, his video, because he's mostly exhibited in an art context, in a contemporary art context. And as you probably indicated earlier, you do receive very interesting feedback from people that looking at these images and position your relationship with your subject matter or the people that work with you in a very sort of conflicted, oppositional place. And I wonder if you could share a little bit more about your story, although I introduced a little bit when we first started this conversation, if you can still share a little bit about how you come here and why you're doing this. Maybe you can talk a little bit more.
So as I've mentioned a while ago, I'm a second generation domestic helper. My mother worked as a domestic worker in Hong Kong until now. And I went to Hong Kong when I just turned 19 when I went there without knowing who she is. I don't have any idea who my mother is because of economic reasons, she need to leave and work. And it's a very typical migrant story where the mother leaves, the children grew up without the mom. So I started with photography because of her, actually. And I'm still doing it because of her. Because my mom is a workaholic. She never go out for holidays. So she's been staying in Hong Kong for more than 20 years now, but she never really saw the city. So I pick up a camera in the hopes of showing her around by going out, photographing people, the places, the areas in Hong Kong, and then showing it to her when I go back home. So that's where my passion for the craft started. It's very personal in so many ways. And my background story actually helped me a lot in doing this personal documentary projects because these migrant workers do not see me as a photographer or someone who's taking away something from them. They see me as someone who is one of them. So, as you mentioned a while ago, my work is more widely seen because it's published on papers, on blogs, website. I think that's part of the process of doing a documentary project. I always feel that after I've done a project, I did the narrative, I collect the materials, it's my responsibility as a photographer to tell their stories and shout it to the world because they allowed me into their lives. The fact that they allowed me into their lives, take these photos, means they want their stories to be heard. That's why I try so hard to have different platforms to show these stories, to show these photographs, like now, and yeah.
Thank you. I think what strikes me most when I first know you and know your work is how real you are, as you don't have that sense of sort of coming from a lot of in the art world and the cultural world, we do have this very weird subconsciousness of being an elite in some regard. But I really appreciate your approach to your work. And I know you told me about your story, you're living off at the airport and you're really fighting on the street and be with the people in the protests and be with the people that, you know, are fighting for the real justice for many of the different difficult issues. And I wonder if you can share a little bit more about what you've been working on right now and also what you're working on in the United States at the moment.
So basically, I live out of a suitcase, so I'm always traveling, and it's very different from my former world where I can only go out once a week. So right now, I'm enjoying these perks of going around different countries to photograph, and I'm currently here right now because of this event, and I'm trying to get the Singapore story out. And yeah, when I first met her, I think Xiaoyu's first impression is this girl is crazy. When I did the presentation in Hong Kong, because honestly, I don't have the typical artist background. I didn't study school. I can't afford it until now. And anyone who wants to give me scholarship? So I don't have that. I don't have that background of being an artist. Or sometimes when people ask me, what's your artist vision or something, I'm like, what the fuck is that? You know, because I cannot explain it in words, because if I can explain it in words, then I'm a writer, but I'm not. So it's a very interesting time for me because I always see this as a journey, you know? Like, people see my social account and they think that it's very glamorous, but no. I always say, that, fuck it, look at me, I'm growing wider because airport food is not healthy, right? So I think I'm lost now.
No, I was just thinking, because you told me a little bit about what you were shooting at the moment.
Yeah.
And maybe you can talk about your experience also just the past few days, because you are working, no?
Oh yeah, I just photographed the election, unfortunately. So I focus on the Asian migrant communities here in New York, and it's very interesting because they gave me stickers at the polling station. I don't have the credentials to go there, so I pretended that I voted. So they gave me these stickers. So being a female and slightly cute kind of helps. Yeah, it was interesting because I voted at 3 polling stations. They gave me stickers that I voted, and I put it all, so it's funny. So I'm working, I covered the election, and it's very interesting to be an observer of what's happening in America right now, and that it also hits me that it affects me in very directly, because I'm a non-immigrant person of color in America right now, and I'm gonna stay here for a month or so, more than a month, and the thing that is running on my brain while I was doing that is, can I go back to America next year? Maybe Trump will finally build a wall against us, Filipinos, Browns. So there's a lot of personal thinking that is going on with photographing the election. I'm not supposed to say anything because I'm a photojournalist. I'm just there to photograph. But then if I don't say anything, then I'm just an object. I'm not a human being. So I was ranting about it on social media and to show you, and I think I need to get it out of my system. So maybe I won't see you all next year because there's a wall now. Yeah.
Okay, my last question would be for Chia-En. I wonder if you can talk a little bit from your perspective as an artist, because I know you work with the migrant domestic workers, and your new project is with the taxi drivers. And then you early on also organized these workshops at the Cube in Taipei, as well as you participated in protest, actually, as a form of your practice. I just wonder if you have these interests in accessing and approaching different community groups. Also for me, what I think is interesting from your work is these personal, very individual perspectives that, you're trying to give to the people that you're working with. Like in the taxi piece, the history is unfolding through the narrative and through the stories of very personal emotions instead of something we will hear from a textbook.
Yeah, it's a I think it's being an activist or being an artist is always a dilemma for me. Because you want to do something that can change the world, but in some way you cannot. Yeah? It's a very painful thing. So for example, like the dreams I document, there's I think the day we had dinner is 11:10, right? So it's the next day of the election. I think that's of my friend have a nightmare last night. So it's kind of a unified, kind of physical impact to us because the dreams, actually the REM sleep stage is a narrow system function like daily life, but just paralyze our muscles. So we have this kind of real experience through the dreams. So that's why I try to use these things to maybe tell people that we are kind of actually the same physically, psychologically, not about the appearance, but we really need to rethink about the whole structure we are living in. I don't know, it's other question, I forgot. Yeah, the very personal practice, the perspective, because they are important, because they are very personal. Like Isa's film, the photos, if you don't see them, you don't know. That's I try to shoot them as private as possible, like the taxi video. I shoot a backside with a very big, huge camera that they don't notice I'm shooting. Because if you use a small camera, they will notice you are trying to capture an image. So that's then through the very personal, private narrative, we can maybe construct a large image.
Well, in order to respect the time that we have, maybe we can open up for a couple of questions you have, if you have any questions to either of the artists. I see someone in the back.
I have a question for Xyza. Is that your name? I'm sorry.
Xyza.
Okay. Because you talked about human worker trafficking. You spoke about human worker trafficking, and you mentioned that some of these people were teachers in their own country. So could you explain a little bit more about the process? What would lead that teacher to come here and work? How does that happen?
Well, in Asia, I'm not saying that all of us in Asia, we have this silly look or way of seeing America as the greatest country in the world. We have the American dream that only happens apparently in dreams, not in reality. So, right? It's dead people, sorry. So I'm like, human labor trafficking happens in a way that you are coerced, you are a victim of fraud. They promise you, for example, the teachers, the trafficker promised them that they will work here as teachers. So they pay thousands of dollars just to come over here in America, and when they arrive, there's nothing. They are forced to work as domestic workers or other menial jobs to be able to pay these traffickers their homes, their food, and it can become a cycle of being a slave. So people ask me questions like, they're teachers, they're smart. Why are they stupid to leave their jobs to be able to come here? The thing is, they were promised that they will have the same job. It's just that there's nothing for them when they arrive here. And of course, for a migrant worker, it's a failure for us to go back to where we came from and show up that I'm a victim of trafficking. People will see me as stupid, as silly. So I'm just gonna stay here and work it out. So that's the usual scene.
Everybody, we want to stick to schedule. We want to respect everyone's hungry stomachs, and possibly they need to go to the restroom. So what we can do is completely take the discussion outside. We have an hour for lunch, and you can ask questions to the artists. Please, respondents, you know, just because you didn't get a chance to ask your question here, you don't have to keep it to yourself. Please have that exchange with Xiaoyu. Thank you so much. And Xyza.
Please just ask Xyza and pose questions directly to her.
And perhaps we can share the video that was not that was missed in another format. We'll share it with you. Thank you, and please come back on time because we're going to go right into schedule at 1 o'clock.